No, here's, we had this is generated by the forum. This is the core blog module. The rest are basically pages and views. You know, some of this stuff was later changed from views to more just a coding backend, just because of some of the limitations we experienced with views and integrating some plugins and stuff of that sort.
Just show them like a view.
Okay, let me log in. You mean the admin interface?
Yeah, no, like show all the views.
Okay. So, so what Drupal does is it'll essentially build a view for you. A view is nothing but some data that's retrieved from the database. It's essentially a query which you could construct with a normal SQL string. You know, select so these fields from this table. Sort by this column and so forth. The view allows you to do that with not having to utilize any code whatsoever, just with the interface. Now, for example, the blog view we have is it's constructed fairly simply. There's a listing of the fields that you're trying to pull in this area. There's the main table. This is essentially node type. Says, okay, what kind of content you're pulling. Drupal allows you to categorize your nodes in terms of type. So for example, a practical example would be if you had, for example, a particular community, maybe these were students, you know, every student would have a first name, their class, you know, you could essentially build that in a node type. Now in your view, you could pull those fields, you know, you could have student name, student class, birth date and so forth. These would be your fields. Then you just filter by class or student, whatever you call the content type. So what Drupal will do in the back end is construct a query, an SQL query, which would go in the tables and pull all the relevant data as specified in the views.
Is this good for populating pages? When you're just creating the initial content, it automatically will populate that page, so it's one less
So, speaking of pages, with every view, you can actually add a display. For example, if you wanted this view to be rendered as a block, for example, here, this is a block view. As you can see, it's in a block area of the page. You could add a display block, and it would essentially construct the same query, but this time generate a block. You could then take that block and include it in a region on your site, which is, in our case, it's the left region of the site. But it's essentially the exact same view. That same view could also be rendered into a page. As I showed you in the blog page, open another tab here. Again, the same exact view. But this time, this is the page rendition of that same view. So how this usually works is you'll perhaps snippet three entries, per se, and then you have a more link, which would essentially take you to the page which would have all the entries for that particular view. That's usually the way it's implemented and used. Filters, that's simply, you know, if anyone's familiar with SQL, if you said select from students where, student name equals so-and-so or node type equals source, that would be your filter. It would also be the sort criteria, which is then how you order that result set. Whether it's, you know, by student name descending, which would be alphabetized. I don't know if you have a numeric field, it would be based on the numeric value with a 0 to 10 or whatever you had in those in that result set. Any questions? Is this necessarily intuitive?
What's the difference between the core modules and 6 and 7?
Yeah, well, so like Nick mentioned in the opening, is that we're using a lot of our sites are Drupal 6. As well as Drupal 7. A couple differences. First of all, in the backend API, the way certain views are constructed, there's also some differences in the user interface. For example, if you want to compare Drupal 6's views user interface to that of Drupal 7, I'll take a second to pull up. What was that structure views? don't have view set up here, do we?
I thought we did. Yeah, right there. It's on the shortcut.
Oh, there we go. Okay.
Oh, you know what? It isn't set up out here.
It isn't?
No.
All right.
No, it isn't set up out here. I think we were just playing with it.
Yeah, we don't.
I apologize. We're just playing with it on this one.
It's into modules. I show, like,
yeah,
so it's built into Drupal right out of the box. It's one of
As far as modules?
Yeah. Things that are already almost just about ready to go for you out of the box.
Right, so things out of the box, you'd get things. Let me just put the module list here. Drupal 6 or 7? Let's start with Drupal 6. Drupal 6 is still the most widely used, right?
Yes.
Right. Drupal 6 is still the most widely used Drupal version.
Yeah, I would suggest maybe start on Drupal 6 at this point, though. If you start from the
beginning. Right, if you're starting, right.
Right, start exactly.
2.7, I'm just going
to... Right, because a lot of things...
Because it's most widely used, it's also old.
Right. A lot of things will very soon get deprecated and... not supported as much as 7. In fact, they're already working on a Drupal 8 version. So, when you go to your module listing, which is located at admin build modules in Drupal 6, it sort of just outlines what comes core. Core simply means that with your base installation, these are the modules that are enabled and that are packaged with the core package of Drupal that you've downloaded from wherever. So, they're kind of categorized into their what they provide, the kind of functionality they provide. And it clearly says your core. Now, core optional, these are the modules that they're core, but they're optional. In essence, you don't have to use it. For example, every site doesn't have to have a blog, and if you're not interested in utilizing a blog in your site, you can simply uncheck it or check it, however you prefer. Now, some modules are mandatory. For example, the core required modules. Block, filter, node, system. Let me start with the node, for example. Without the node module, Drupal would not be a system at all because it entirely relies on nodes. Everything feeds off of a node. Relationships are created based on nodes. If you're a developer and you created a custom module, it will most likely interact with a node in one way, shape, or form. So without the node module, essentially Drupal wouldn't really be able to fulfill its purpose. So likewise, the system module, the user module, you know, every site will at some point has to have a user. Even if you're not explicitly adding users to your site, you are the root user by creating a Drupal-based installation. And, also the blocks. There's core blocks or things like the admin blocks, which the user login block and things like that.
You said custom module. What language is that, by the way?
PHP.
Yeah. Oh, right, it's all PHP.
Like WordPress, right?
Absolutely. So, okay. Joomla as well, right? Joomla.
They're all PHP,
most of them.
The structure of WordPress and Drupal is fairly similar as far as the structure of their folders.
Right.
Drupal is a little bit different. Drupal is a little bit more complicated as far as the way they like to set up the structure. They all essentially do the same thing. Drupal's a fantastic community. They have a ton of core users that are just doing this simply for like the good of open source. I mean, this is truly open source at its finest. These guys love this stuff more than they probably love their families.
Yeah.
I mean, there's some hardcore guys. They've come up with some really innovative ways to present stuff to the web.
There's always an answer out there.
Right.
It's usually right on this site right here. Like,
right.
Think of anything that you would want to put on your website, any kind of feature, and just search in there, and you'll probably find a module ready to go for you.
Right.
So, what kind of restrictions do they put on your data, for them to be able to read it and know what you have to claim?
Restrictions as far as.
Like, is there a certain schema that you have to?
Well, for example, in Drupal.org, for your module to, first of all, if you be even available in Drupal.org for download, it would have to go through a overview process where, they would check the documentation and make sure that your module is well documented, that it's secure, that you're using best practices, because you could essentially write a module that kind of does the functionality, but you're not really utilizing the Drupal system. because Drupal provides a way of doing everything. You know, if you needed to render a form, you'd use a hook form, things of that sort. So all that is really looked at very well before your module can actually be available for download to the community. So that's if that answers your question. And if you're interested, you could create a login in Drupal.org.
Now that I'm thinking about the question, I don't know if the question...
Is it appropriate? Well, so...
No, that is appropriate. Were you talking about the site, it's the website itself, or were you talking about Drupal?
Well, I didn't really build a WordPress site, but I had to maintain one because someone built it. And I added to like RSS feed or whatever, right?
Sure.
And I saw that on the back end, it seemed like the guy who set it up, he had a schema to follow as far as getting certain content,
right?
So that WordPress could use it, you know, which makes sense. You know, how is it going to know this module? How's it going to know how to read this data? Unless there's a certain schema already set,
right?
He has to follow.
It works entirely differently.
Okay.
WordPress is a lot more finicky, and you're seeing a lot more PHP all the time in WordPress.
Right.
But you don't have to see the PHP in here.
Right.
In fact, this kind of Drupal way of thinking, where you do the least amount of modification possible, and you spend more time thinking about what the right combination of modules is,
right.
So you don't do any custom coding, because kind of custom code is bad because you've got to maintain it for the rest of time.
Right.
Whereas if you can make it out of existing stuff, then you're more sound that way.
Right.
So, and the schema stuff, it handles for you. Okay. Part of what Drupal's doing is an abstraction engine for the data.
Right.
And in Drupal 7, you can start to swap out the different databases, so you could swap out MySQL for SQL Server if you felt inclined.
Right.
I don't know why you would, but
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Because there's a lot of Java people that are now moving over, and they want to still work on a PC.
Still want to use their back end.
that's the reason why.
Oh, yeah.
Is that, you know, it's funny because we actually had... Recently, we had a meeting with our internal Java Cold Fusion people, and they said, "Hey, we want to learn PHP, you know, because this is the way to go." I mean, it truly is. You know, 10 years from now, it'll be something different, but I still think at the core, Drupal is still going to have a presence. That, you know, the evolution is going to just continue to move in a progressive way. And I think part of your question was answered with when he was explaining views.
Abstraction layer.
Right. Like, you're not having to do all the manual manipulation like you do in WordPress. And Brett is absolutely right about Drupal 7. Drupal 7's been phenomenal for us. And we definitely... Everything we've done moving forward has gone to Drupal 7, except for Atrium, which unfortunately Atrium hasn't become, which is basically another core group of people that takes the base Drupal install and completely modifies it and creates like this one-off of Drupal, so that it's then its own variation of the custom or of the content management system. And that's actually, it's great because a lot of, and you guys are actually...
We're using OpenPublic as well. So I think one of the interesting things now about the future of Drupal is, that it's inevitably the direction that government's going in CMS, just the volume of adoption it's getting, and the size of the community makes it pretty much a foregone. It's like the size of that community means it would be absurd to choose anything else.
Right.
Because in the end, it's not goodness that matters, it's about sustainability that matters.
Right.
Yeah, if it does everything you want, can you sustain it? But the future, as I see it, is all about distributions. So OpenAtrium was a fantastic intranet in a packaged up intranet that you can just use. OpenPublic is something I want to put in a big word for here, because OpenPublic was built out of the work done by Phase 2 on house.gov and also on White House websites. And they basically took that good federal government base and made a distribution. So rather than going and taking the Drupal distribution and working out how you're going to configure a base Drupal, you actually have a starting point which is a good base for a federal website.
Right.
And we then also took that and extended that distribution to have an extra set of features that were designed for the sort of more kind of state level and local level. And those distributions provide a great way to kind of start up, because you come to Drupal.org and you could be building a site for a hairdresser's or your local mechanic or a government, and it's just a little bit too abstract. Whereas you say, oh, I want to do an intranet, I'll take Open Atrium. I want to do a government website, I'll take Open Public. I want to do a city website, I'll go and use the Achieve City, was our variant of it that sits on the web there. And you just kind of go and grab the one that makes sense for you. And those distributions provide a lot of the good heavy lifting. So quite a lot of, kind of when you take one of those distributions, a lot of this lifting has already been done for you. So you'll get one of these that already have blogs set up, that have the news content type set up. So the things that are commonly used will already be there. And that makes them absolutely fantastic. With the exception that sometimes some of those distributions will become dated and you need to work it out to move away from them.
Right.
And with Atrium, there's still an open question there about who's going to make that move to the next level.
And this is actually something that we've been talking about internally in our group is that, and I think it's great that you guys took the federal package and kind of packaged it back for the community. Like, we've been talking about that particular thing just for New York State, because everybody keeps coming to us and saying, hey, we really want to do a Drupal website. You know, what do we do? And it gives you the flexibility so that when the core modules that you need to come out of the box with videos, audio, press releases, the video slider, a blog, your different feeds, like, it's all there in one tight little package, so you're just pushing that out instead of having to go and do exactly what he was talking about and collecting all the information on here. Because what's started to happen is people are duplicating modules on here, and some work good, some work great, and some are terrible. You'll install a module and it'll crash your entire database.
After disabling it.
And we actually found that this morning, that a core module in Drupal 7 actually did that to us. It actually crashed our database this morning. So, we've had a lot of progression with this from starting the governor's site in January to now. We actually have an install of Drupal 6 with another install of Drupal 7 actually nested inside of it, because they have some very specific criteria at the governor's office and they want specific things, and unfortunately the functionality in 6 just doesn't translate to 7. 7's been very robust for us. We have over a dozen sites in it now, and it's been issue free. One of the sites that we have, go to NYWorks. This is actually a site for the regional councils. The governor's initiative that he first announced in January. The original inception of this was that it would be a place for information for each one of the individual councils inside of New York State, which is broken up into 10 specific regions highlighted in the map. Well, this was then supposed to be a tool for those regional councils to be able to get information quickly and then disseminate it to their user base. What's ended up happening is this kind of has morphed into micro sites inside of this, so that each region has its own essential website inside of there, and they're able to manipulate the content based on their own users' needs. So you'll start to see that each one of them is kind of taking their own content and adding it to what we gave them as a base template.
Right.
And it's neat to see how quickly this can be done. In some of the other content management systems, if you wanted to take and make a change globally across a site, it sometimes takes hours or weeks to do. We could simply, by one click, swap out the entire footer of the site and implement something completely different within a matter of seconds. That's how agile the system is. And that's part of the reason why it works so well for the governor, because things are constantly changing. One day he wants to do Hurricane Irene coverage, the next day he wants to talk about translating all the websites inside New York State for 6 different languages. So, you know, there's always things that are constantly changing. This site's a perfect example. This site went originally for, it had about 15 pages with probably 10 or 15 pieces of data connected to it on each page. These now have hundreds and hundreds of pieces of data inside of this that the councils have collected and published to the site that are actually hidden within the expandables. So, you know, these are things that, so now next year, when this finishes in November, all this information can then be packaged up, archived, set aside, so that next year when they start to populate all these documents, they have a fresh blank canvas, but they still preserve all the information they had from this year. This has been a fun project.
You know, I have a similar business problem right now, and I've just been assigned a project to basically do a public safety web, which is supposed to be a combination of DCJS, Department of Corrections, State Police, plus some of the smaller agencies. And they all have, you know, their own external website. And the, you know, the idea is that we want, from a public standpoint, for the public to be able to come to one place and either go to the site for, you know, corrections, to go look up inmates, or to go look up if there's a sex offender living in your neighborhood or something like that. But at the same point, we also want it to be theme-based, meaning to say, you know, you shouldn't have to know that it's this acronym agency, DCJS, where you go look up, you know, sex offenders. You just need to know, hey, what's in my neighborhood, and have everything presented. And this kind of shows me maybe, well, I'm the project manager, so I'm trying to figure out, all right, what are different ways to implement this? Because there's one thing to just stand up a new site, put up something brand new, or, you know, but I've got to get from where we are now with 8 different sites to one site in this kind of regional council thing. Is, you know, kind of solves one problem that I've got 8 different agencies with 8 different organizations with 8 different ways of looking at the world, and, you know, that's all fine and good, so I got to preserve that. But at the same point, now I want to set this situation up where we're collaborating more, thinking more about it from the citizen's view at a particular location within the state, you know, rather than 8 different ways of looking at the same data.
So this was a issue that we just were currently presented with. So the governor decides that he wants to be transparent. So
just as a quick note, my app is the second piece on there.
This one?
No, Sex Offender Locator app.
Oh yes.
We gave him that.
Yeah, I noticed that yesterday.
Cool.
The one on Facebook.
Number two
on the slideshow, Cyprian.
Oh, okay.
It's sits on Facebook.
This one.
Yeah. I actually put it together yesterday when you were talking about where you were from. I'm like, oh, I almost guarantee Eric built that. So, scroll down to the bottom of the page, Cyprian. So the governor decided transparency was the way that he wanted to go with this site. So what he decided was one way to do that, and this goes back to Remy with open data, is that everybody in New York State has events. Every agency, their commissioner goes someplace, they have different walks, they have different, all kinds of different things that go on throughout the state. So we wanted a way to be able to centralize this so that when a user comes to New York State, they can figure out where they're getting this information from. So this right now takes the information from every PIO throughout New York State, and they have the ability to log into the back end of this, enter their information, populate the information to the data table, and then the information is then approved by an approval process, and then disseminated back to the table itself. The other thing we're doing is we're working on a way to take existing APIs off of other agency sites so they're not having to manually re-enter all their information. Parks and Recreation has something like 350 events per month on their site, but they already have an existing API, so we're able to, they're the ones we're actually betaing this with, is take their information and then populate the right back into the table. And this is actually goes back to what Luke was discussing yesterday with the data tables. This is just another version of the data table that, which is a fantastic jQuery. And that's the other thing, is that you're able to not only integrate PHP and HTML, you're also able to integrate other things outside of there, jQuery, JavaScript, Java, other applications into this seamlessly.
And the ones that are a little more complicated, like the jQuery ones I've dealt with, sometimes have a module built for them to help it integrate more without hitting a lot of the errors that you might hit when you're trying to do it just with the jQuery plugin.
You know, the other thing with this is with this thing is also inside of here we have where the governor's been. Scroll to the map tab. Where we've actually started, see where he's been, down.
Third tab. Oh, goodness.
Where we started to integrate Google's API.
Google Maps, yep.
And it's actually, you know, we've actually learned a lot of stuff about how Google's API works. They actually have probably the nicest API that anybody's ever came up with. The way that Google, we figured this out a few weeks ago, that Google figures out directions, you could actually take and put in your browser, it's what, Google.maps, ?q equals, and then you could literally write the address, and it would take you to that screen that tells you how to get directions to somebody's house. And that's how unsophisticated Google's API is that they know that if you just put that you live at 55 Railroad Avenue in Albany, New York, and you just write that in your browser, Google will take you right to that point. So to be able to integrate this has been seamless. And there's a lot of flexibility to this. We're also, we had had a version of this that you were able to then do this with DOMS and then unhighlight individual colors on the map.
Depending on what category they're
from. Depending on what category. So, you know, and the other part of this is like the little thing on the right-hand side on the bottom where it says Citizens Connect. This is actually an integration with Cold Fusion that from an existing data set that we had from the previous administration that they wanted to utilize in this administration. And it was just a contact the governor form that they built in Cold Fusion. We were able to very seamlessly integrate it directly into this. So we've had a lot of, it's been a large learning curve because there isn't, especially in upstate New York, there isn't a huge Drupal community. Down in the city, there's an enormous Drupal community. But up here, we've had, you know, we've had pitfalls. We've learned best practices, what not to do, what to do. And we've had some fun with it. So these are just a few examples of things that the governor's been doing with Drupal.
So like this page, did you do this all through modules, or did you have to get into code at all?
So what modules are running on this page?
No, there's actually no modules at all running on this page.
Right.
It's all
blocks.
It's all...
Well, I mean, okay.
This...
The,
that's a Google map.
This is an integration of the Google Maps API, which is all jQuery. Then you also have the, you know, how this basically works is you have an HTML structure of, you know, which you can create, well, it's actually all JavaScript. You can create these markers. So what we've done is each one of these markers are now nodes, which you can create using the Drupal's forms. So you'll create a node, and once that's saved, it is then populated onto the map. And how that's done is, unfortunately, here there was not really a module that was pre-built that you could utilize off, to integrate with the Google Maps. At least we didn't find one.
Have you seen one?
So this had...
Really? You have one?
Yeah.
What's the name?
Keeping to the 101 level, I can kind of share that detail with you afterwards.
Yeah,
we've got a fair amount of map mashing it, stuff that we're doing.
So this has to sort of had to be custom code in the back end to just retrieve a data set, which are the nodes, and then present it by the JavaScript.
I guess my question more was, do you have to, like, could you take things out of the box even for, I mean, there seems to be a lot going on in this page, or did you have to, like, get inside the code in some way to make it do it?
It's really up to what you want to do. If you want to wipe everything out and just hard code.
What did you guys do?
Well, we did a lot of hard coding with this, probably because of the time frame we had to put it together.
But you could do it the other way.
Right, absolutely. Yes. You could actually implement all these as blocks.
Yep.
And where you just take the code and then put it in each block and then assign it.
And this is actually, as this has evolved, all this stuff has then been brought back in as blocks.
Into blocks.
And this is...
And then you reuse them.
And then we reuse them. Because what happens is there's also additions to this site that weren't originally anticipated. The original anticipation of this was going to be one single landing page that was going to house just this particular content. Then it kind of evolved into something different.
Right.
And now it's turned into, there's a lot more that they want to add to this, that this has become his, like, hub for transparency. So, we're as this evolves, these things have gotten moved into blocks. Some modules have been integrated into this to control certain functions. The one neat thing locate. The locate module, which is the one that has to do with translation.
Right.
We actually found that it was playing with our code because it was trying, when we originally set this up, the way some of this data is brought in, it's brought in specifying the UID. And what it was doing was it was actually asking for the English UID. So it wasn't allowing for the content to be displayed into our site. Well, in disabling that, it actually cleared our data set. So luckily, we back up 14 times a day, so we were quickly able
to revert to it.
But, you know, these were things that we never anticipated. We've actually, there's an online chat that we have for the weekends. And basically what it is the governor gets on and communicates with the public. And basically what we did was we took the core blog module and modified it. We took basically the complete functionality of the blog, ripped it apart, added some jQuery to it and put it back together so that it actually looks like you're having a conversation. The person posts, the user posts, or the admin posts a answer or question and then replies to the answer and the answer displays underneath it. We added jQuery to this so that it would actually then display it every 5 seconds through the Ajax, so it didn't look like you don't have to constantly refresh the page. So, you know, we also figured out that the core blog, the way it's built, displays the blog in the order that it was submitted. So if something was submitted yesterday at 9 o'clock, that's going to end up on the top. And then if it was the next time after that goes... After that, well, we figured out how to be able to modify that so that we're able to do it based on when it's submitted. So we've, you know, tried to try to use the core, but then modify the core to suit what we need.
Right.
And it's flexible that way. And like Cyprian was talking with the views, in the views you have a lot of the control to implement this flexibility to make it work for whatever your needs are.
Right. There's also a lot of modules like which Ratchet plugins. For example, what's one of the plugins that jQuery plugin with views? This, for example, is called ddblot. It's essentially, it's the data set is generated by a view, but this functionality is all jQuery. So, you know, the contributor had created a jQuery plugin which then plugs into views, which allows you to style the view in this way, render it in this way, as opposed to a list, a simple list like what we saw in the blog, for example. There are apart from this, there's many other plugins you could utilize, which simply by going to Drupal.org, you'll find them all. And if you wanted to, another example.
I think there's a kind of interesting thing to mention about the use of modules. One thing to mention is use is a good indicator of how well maintained it is. And Drupal.org has a nice listing of modules used by popularity, so you can see if the module is in production use. And that helps you choose the right module, because you might have something that looks like it's just what you want, but not enough people use it to be sure that you can keep using it. Another thing to mention is about using features. So the idea of a feature is just being able to install a module and all its configuration in one hit rather than using modules.
Right.
And once you start to have features that you want to repeat between several sites, you're better off packaging that up as a feature and moving it around that way than configuring modules, because modules are all configuration. And when you want a reusable thing, you want something that behaves more like code. Right. And to that extent, features are very useful.
And this is actually what he was just talking about. If you scroll down to the bottom of this.
Oh boy.
There it is.
Reported installs.
Reported installs.
Right.
So views is a very...
when you search for modules, you can ask it to sort by use or popularity or I don't know what the other options are. Oh, by your version. We find with using 7 that... we find some modules that aren't quite ready for 7 yet, but we try to use them anyway, and they usually work. Sometimes not.
Okay. Sometimes they don't.
Could you talk about how approval paths work in terms of content? Can you have, you know,
there's different
approvals from, you know, because again, my situation is I've got eight different sets of users.
That's what we're using on this. We haven't had success. We're having
quieter
success.
7 I don't have to worry about, but there's one rogue out there that we just want to make sure has somebody else look at it.
Yeah, there's a whole module for that one. It's called
Workflow. There's more than one, but Workflow's my favorite as well.
Right.
There are many different ways you can set that up.
Right.
Maestro's a good one in 6.
Seven.
Does Maestro work in 7 as well?
Maestro's in 7, yeah.
Oh, okay, because in some of the chats it was only 2 we were looking at. So, yeah, Workbench is kind of an obvious.
Yeah,
Workbench.
Rules. Yeah, so there's different ways you can implement it. For our use, we found Workbench is the most robust for managing that by quite a distance. But there are kind of a good number of different ways you can set that up, and that's really kind of a technical implementation question based on your use, and
right.
You can get into really complex scenarios.
Right.
But I think.
But just tying that back to this, you know, what you had mentioned before, the federal government, the WhiteHouse.gov, you took that and then.
Well, Phase 2 Phase 2 were involved in both the White House and House.gov projects,
right.
And the work that they got out of that they used to create Open Public. So that's Phase 2, a consultancy based in DC.
Right.
And they do a lot of work with distributions. So they manage the Open Public distribution, which is the magazines. They manage the Open Nation publication, which is an intranet, and Open Public, which was really intended for federal agencies.
So, but just tying back to the workflows, like when you take that down, it would already have have the workflows that they used, or then you have to kind of rebuild that whole thing?
That's open. OpenPublic doesn't, but OpenAtrium has some of that.
OpenAtrium does. The problem with OpenAtrium is OpenAtrium is really more for collaboration.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a perfect... We actually use it for collaboration for our sites. Drupal out of the box doesn't have any type of workflow process
pre-built
into it. It kind of does, but there's a lot of manipulation that goes into it.
The only most pre-built one I found was Rules, because that sort of allows you to specify an action given an event. The others are sort of, you have to put a couple modules together, but Rules is probably...
If you're a programmer, probably.
Well,
right.
As a non-programmer, I wouldn't want to go near Rules. It's just too hard. But I mean, that's it. At this point, into detail, this is probably the hardest part of a Drupal implementation. It isn't theming, it's not picking a module, it's actually, how do I make my permissions work the way that I want them to?
Yeah.
And, a lot of people find themselves, this is kind of the biggest gotcha I've seen, find themselves thinking they want some kind of hierarchic group-based permission system,
right.
And everybody on that path starts thinking, oh, what manages groups of things? Oh, let's use organic groups and try and like warp organic groups to manage my permissions. And everybody that tries that ends up with a completely horrible permission system that can never be made to work right. So that would be my one word of caution there. If you've got a consultancy house saying to you, we think you should forge organic groups to manage your permissions, go and change the way you're doing permissions. Don't ever let that mess up your implementation. That'd be really bad for you. But other than that, it's kind of, I just recommend Workbench every day.
Yeah, we've tried to implement Workbench unsuccessfully.
Okay. Well,
so that's why the only we had actually gone to Rules and then modified Rules.
Mm-hmm.
We really liked Maestro.
Mm-hmm.
Maestro was actually a very cool. Seemed like a well thought out idea, and then implementing it, it didn't implement very well. So we went back to Rules. But you're absolutely right. There's 15 different directions to go with workflows.
Okay.
And it's based more on exactly what you said, on how defined you want to get your permissions. If you're okay with somebody being able to publish a specific piece of content and having the ability to either publish or unpublish it, in the core you could probably accomplish that without really having to create any type of workflow. If you want to get more defined, where you have a hierarchy of administrators, sub-administrators, content posters, and then people that are able to access specific pieces of content, then you have to get into some type of workflow management. And it gets very...
Yeah. I was just thinking of that regional economic development council where,
yep.
Okay, maybe for the main page it goes through one
and that's actually
one
how,
level of hierarchy, but if you're within the region, that region has complete control and go for it.
And that's actually exactly how that's set up, is that the main portal of this is controlled by OFT. And then each region has the ability to have their own users inside of that region be able to publish content to that particular region. They're not able to see any other content other than their specific region, and they're able to add whatever they want. They also have the ability to also add menus inside of there, and that was fairly easily implemented. And that was done simply by Rules.
There's also notifications set up on that. So.
Right.
Once the content is then posted, the supervisor or the reviewer of that particular region would get an email that says, okay, so-and-so has been published, you want to go ahead and allow that. Or
I can expect my phone to be ringing off the hook.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you're on Graph, it's only one user admin. You could just create a role for them.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. Just have them notify the person when they have something published.
I think as a project manager, this is probably a level of detail you want to delegate to a programmer.
I have to make the sale first. How we're going to do this.
I'll help you.
Yeah. I think that, whatever you want to achieve is achievable is kind of the best message that you can take from this setting. It's,
yeah,
it's very configurable.
You can do pretty much anything you want in within the context of Drupal. Like, there's no limit to what you can accomplish, providing that it's a reasonable fit. Like, I mean, by reasonable, I mean you can essentially shove a round peg in a square hole and it'll still work. And it'll still be pretty good. It's all how much you put into it. If you don't give it the care and you don't give it the treatment that a CMS needs, it's going to be crappy.
Can somebody advocate for the devil, please? And like, tell me, like, all right, what scenario would Drupal not work? Like, if as a developer, what scenario would you choose something other than Drupal or content?
When it's not a CMS, is when to not choose Drupal. I hear lots of people in the community, every now and then, somebody will pipe up and say, oh, we could build a CRM using Drupal. Don't. It's a bad idea.
You could
build a CRM using Drupal. I was at a conference a couple of months ago, and somebody on stage was talking about using it as a record management, as like an inventory management system for a record store. It's not for that. The scenario that makes sense is what is web content and user-generated content. And it really does rock at that. Don't have it do anything else. Yeah, it does those things really well. The community is focused on making it do those things really well. And making it do those things really well takes thousands of people, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of hours a year, to keep it doing as being as good what it is. Everything else you try and wedge in there is just future maintenance you don't need, and you're kind of better off building it isolated and then integrating using views or creating a little module or widget that sits there that brings it in. But anything content-based, there's perhaps arguments against sort of things that do heavy streaming. I wouldn't build YouTube using it, for example.
No, that's
okay. What else wouldn't you use it for? I'm kind of stuck apart from like heavy streaming stuff.
That's pretty much it. Like, I if you're using it as like a, but you can still build like a Flickr-like application around Drupal without a problem. Like, you just have to know what you're going to be doing before you get into it. Like, if it's just an amorphous vision of what it's going to be, it's going to be hard to get all the pieces you want and all the modules you need and integrate them all on top of it. It can grow out of hand very quickly.
How about performance? Is there a benchmark?
It's super. Because I was telling you. I actually used to run NCAA.com, which is built on Drupal, and it has about 500,000 to 1 million page views during March and April for March Madness, and it performs absolutely flawlessly. It requires a lot of man, but it's for 500,000 users, it scales very, very well to anything you can possibly find.
The extremes, I think, are The Economist and the White House.
Oh, yeah.
They obviously have a lot of visitors.
Sure.
And it takes a lot of work to make it do that. It's not like your default Drupal installation's good to a certain point, but then you need to have put thought into that. And there's standard methods, so there's using the right kind of caching, making sure you're using the right kind of reverse proxies. So if you're not using pounds and Memcached, then they're kind of the obvious things, and you kind of get into more fine tuning. But then there's also a good community of people out there talking about what they're doing. So the guy from The Economist kind of blogs a lot about like their auto test, their volumes, and how they do those things. So
it seems to me, in my experience with PHP, is that usually when you create a component, it's like one PHP page for each component.
Yeah.
So if you have all these components, you're just putting them all together. So on the server side, it seems like it would be requesting all these files, and that would spike up all the time. I may not understand it at all. So.
The big thing about Drupal is how absolutely independent it is on its database. It is absolutely 100% driven by how well you can manage the database and how effective you can get it to run, and which goes on top of like using good caching and writing just good SQL and knowing how to manage your data. It's really a huge juggling act when you
run a Drupal website of any size is managing the data effectively and managing the front end how it's acquired.
Do you recommend like running it on your own servers or doing a cloud pipelines?
Right now, inside of New York State, there are no existing servers. So that's a no-brainer that, you know, no. We currently have it sitting in the cloud. And knock on wood, it's...
I'd second that. There's no reason to put it on your servers. There's no advantage to cluttering up your own environments with that hardware.
I mean, development, everybody, we have instance running on everybody's machine for development. And we also have development environments that sit in the cloud, so.
I was just wondering if you had individual and then a development out of cloud.
Yes, we actually have. Every environment, that's the other thing, is that every environment has three processes. It has a development process, a QA process, and a production environment. The development is, we like to just call it our playground. Everybody can do whatever they want. They can crash the database. It doesn't matter. The QA is for us to show the governor so that he can see what we've been playing with, and then production's live. If you mess with the production and you kill it, then... Ryan gets to whack you with a stick. So for the most part, we have those three different environments so that, God forbid, we've tested it as much as we possibly could so that when it hits the production, it's live, we have zero issues. The one thing we have found is you can over JavaScript this very easily. You can put
conflicts. Yes. Yes.
And that's the biggest.
The first thing I learned is jQuery is built into it. I had to find that out the hard way a few times.
That you can easily just. It's limitless what you can put in here, and you can overcomplicate yourself very, very quickly.
You always have to remember keep it simple as much as possible because you can go overboard really quickly when you start seeing all these shiny.
Right.
And then it just becomes a lot to manage.
I have a question. Since is there any type of version control?
Yeah.
Because I notice I think it's a home ability sometimes. If you make a change to a page, you can click save instead of preview and. Something isn't working, and then you want to go back to what was in the body of that page before. How do you get there?
Well, I think revisions.
Yeah, revisions.
Yeah, there's a revisions module. I think we're using like 5.5 or 6.5 or something. So we have an older version, but there's a revisions thing where it'll just put a tab right next to the view and edit, so you can just fork a page, and then you'll be able to go back to that page as you've edited. So
there's revision. Basically, where you get the edit option. There's just an extra option there. It shows you each update, and you can click on it and see what it looked like at a particular update.
Oh, that's perfect.
You can't roll back to a previous one, but you can copy and paste the content into a new one. So you can't say, I want the version that was 3 ago. Just say, I want a new version and copy and paste the content through.
I've gotten to a point where luckily I had the page as it was open in another tab, so I could go and just view source and grab the code that back out of that and save it. But if it wasn't for that, I would have lost a lot of stuff that was repairing. So. That's fine. I mean, there's no version control.
Anybody have any other questions? Ideas?
Just talk about kind of working towards getting everybody into a common distribution. So basically, we've got this distribution that we've based in.